So you're here, Brexit Blues, we're here to discuss. We are going to be discussing Britain's decision to pull out of the Union, the European Union, a great force, not just for the economic success of Europe, but for its political stability too. Remember, it was born in the ashes of the Second World War. At least that is what the founders and supporters of the great European project believed. But a majority of the British electorate clearly see things differently and voted as they see it to take back control. So what we're going to be discussing now is why they did that, what it means for Britain economically and politically, and perhaps most important of all for this audience, what does Brexit tell us, if anything, about the new currents in world politics? So a beer-swilling, fag-smoking millionaire banker called Nigel Farage, you've probably all heard of him, can rightly claim to be the architect of Brexit. Many of you will have seen a photograph of him and Donald Trump grinning triumphantly in front of some very spectacularly garish gold elevator doors in the Trump Towers just days after Trump had been elected president. I mean, why I bring that up is because it illustrated gloriously the affinity the two of them feel, and suggests, of course, that this is a wider trend than just a British thing. So join us now, I've written, on a journey into the motherlode of the wave of unreason that appears to be sweeping the globe. And Dhaka Litfest has assembled the perfect panel, no understatement necessary, to perform this autopsy on democracy in Britain and the world. We have Rosamund Urwin. Ros is one of Britain's leading newspaper journalists with a weekly column in the British capital's newspaper of record, The Evening Standard. She's been following closely Brexit throughout the referendum period, as has journalist and author Alex Preston. He's written three award-winning novels. His first, This Bleeding City, was set during the financial crisis of 2008. And that crisis, of course, was, as we'll be discovering, an important influence on Brexit. Ben Judah over here traveled Britain during the run-up to the Brexit referendum, speaking to, I think I've written here, I'm not sure whether it is literally true, but I've said literally hundreds of ordinary people. Okay, hundreds. His latest book is about contemporary London, but his real passion, I think it's fair to say, is Russian politics, which again is, as you will discover, is very relevant to this discussion. Ben is the author of a magnificent portrait of Russia under Vladimir Putin, Fragile Empire. Now, as well as discussing these issues with the panel, we want to know what you think too, and I want you to signal to me, I can't actually see you at the moment, but maybe the lights will change a bit. I want you to signal to me if you've got any questions or comments you want to make. Now, I'm going to be utterly, I will be honest with you, I'm going to be utterly, utterly ruthless with you. We're very short of time. We don't have time for people to stand up and give really long kind of, you know, views on what they think is happening. What we've got time for is very crisp comments, very crisp questions from people. So I will interrupt you if you go on, but you are most welcome to contribute to this debate. And again, what I think is really important is we try and push this out from just Britain and look at what we think Brexit means for the world. So with that in mind, let us begin. And first off, I'm gonna ask a slightly kind of provocative question to all my questions will be provocative, I hope. But I'm gonna ask, why should anyone, and I'm gonna start with you, Ros, why should anyone be interested, anyone outside of Britain, be interested in whether Britain is part of the European Union? Why or not? Why on earth should anyone care?
Well, you could see it in the context, and it ties very neatly with Trump, as we've seen by the affinity Trump and Nigel Farage have, into this idea that there's an anti-establishment movement sweeping across the West, and in fact, more broadly, maybe. And I think also, for me, it was a particularly fascinating campaign because it was another failure of the pollsters. We've heard a lot about that, obviously. Hillary Clinton was expected to win by the pollsters. And again, this is another thing where actually now pollsters have reviewed their position and said probably Leave was ahead all along, and there wasn't a sense of urgency in our country. And that's something I think everywhere could learn from, frankly, that sometimes it seems and I think there's a broader thing there too, which is that you think it's easy to push the status quo. And if you're going to pin your campaign on support for the status quo, you need to be sure that people are happy with the way things are. And that applies anywhere.
Very good point. Alex.
Yeah, I mean, I think that the moment that we're experiencing now, why this matters for the people in this room and the people around us in Dhaka is because there are two ways of viewing Brexit. The first is as the last cry of a dying order. This is the kind of uneducated, unglobalized populations of the West, the blue-collar workers in the States, asserting their last competitive advantage, which is the right to vote in a democratic Western democratic process. The other thing we could see, so this is in some ways a referendum on globalization. I think interestingly for a literary festival, this is about narratives. This is about the fact that too many people in Britain felt that this huge dividend that has been conferred upon the world by globalization, the fact that so many people have benefited from it. In Britain, there were too many people who, whether it is true or not, perceived themselves as not having benefited enough from globalization.
And obviously, the echoes of that in America as well. Ben, why does this matter?
Well, I think
you need your mic.
I think the main reason that it should matter here is that if Brexit and Trump's election presage the disintegration of Western Euro-Atlantic institutions, that is a failure for at least the next 10 or 15 years to have any effective global governance institutions that can deal with the threat of climate change. I mean, if you're worried about the rivers eating up more of your country here, you should be worried about whether or not even the kind of incipient and flawed international organizations like the EU are crumbling.
Okay, so that's why it matters. That's why you should be here. That's why you've made the right decision to come into this room. First off, though, I just think, out of honesty, we should come clean and we should say how we voted. I mean, are we overwhelmingly, as I suspect, a Remain panel? I just think, for honesty, which is not to say we won't reflect the Leave arguments, but come on, would you Remain or Leave?
I voted for Remain.
Remain?
Yeah, Remain.
I voted Remain.
Yeah, I think increasingly a kind of sceptical Remain. I mean, I was very fervent about it at the time, and maybe just because I'm an optimist. And God, what a day! You can either choose this session or the death of literature next door. I'm sorry, we're not bringing more cheer into your lives today. But you know, because I'm an optimist, I am trying now to see ways in which Leave isn't just racism.
Okay, we're going to come on to that. But first off, the obvious question is the question that all of us, every Remain voter, was asking on June the 24th, the morning of June the 24th, what was Britain thinking? Who wants to take that? What do you think? What happened?
Alex should start because he's based in Kent, where everyone was thinking that.
Yeah, so let me just
you're embedded
sort of set the scene.
Leaveland.
I grew up in London and have lived in London all my life. And 3 months before the Brexit vote, I moved from London to the university where I teach, which is in Kent. And Kent is the heartland of Brexit, and there were
yeah,
some.
So although Kent is a southern I was going to say a southern state, it's a southern county of Britain. It's actually is a very kind of traditional and
very traditional. There are some pockets of real poverty, huge unemployment, and the other thing is, you know, we're talking a lot about Trump's wall at the moment. If you think about where Kent is in the southeast, it is up against the channel, the English Channel, which is our wall, and it is seeing a lot of the first signs of immigration, or the first issue, the arrivals of immigrants from Europe, coming from all over the world. So my sense, talking to people around me, so there were times when it felt like a kind of personal rebuke Brexit. I was the only Remain voter in my village. And yet I was very interested in knowing why people had voted to leave. I was asking everyone I met. And there was a view put about, I think, a lot by the kind of London-based media that this was, you know, that this was the reassertion of some kind of racism, that this was a sense of Britain being much more right-wing, and this idea of the Overton window, the views which it is acceptable to express in any community, in any society, suddenly becoming much more right-wing and radical. I don't think that's the case. I think, firstly, this was a protest vote. I think people didn't think there was any chance of this happening. The polls said there wasn't any chance of this happening, and I think a lot of people said, I want to give the establishment a bloody nose. They didn't necessarily look into the details as much as they should have done, but it was a sense of a protest vote. Just very quickly, the second thing I would say is, and this is how I'm trying to be positive about Leave, I think there are a lot of people in the UK who are in the position of a lot of people around the world, which is they have seen the stability of their jobs hugely undermined. They have seen the, you know, this idea of Uber as a kind of model for the 21st century company, I think, is horrifying. They are working zero-hour contracts. They've seen their pension, you know, final salary pensions eroded or eradicated. Suddenly, people are feeling that the world is not looking after them. And I heard that again and again and again. People were watching people like me who had done well out of, you know, property prices and a reasonable career. They were watching people like me benefiting while they did not benefit. Their salaries have remained the same for, you know, in real terms for the past 15 years.
Yeah, and that was a very strong theme, wasn't it? And there was a great article in The Guardian where somebody described being at a lecture, a discussion about Brexit in the north of England. And somebody was talking about the economics of Brexit and talking about the impact that there would be, the negative impact on economic growth. We'll go into this later, I know it's contested. But saying there would be a negative impact on economic growth. And someone in the audience went, well, that's your growth. That's not my growth, that's your growth. And there is this feeling, just as there is in America, Ben, of a detachment, a separation in Britain, a division in Britain. But also a sense that people weren't listening to the arguments. There was no rational debate about Brexit, was there?
There was a rational debate about it.
Was there?
No, I think so, yeah. But what Remain voters didn't want to engage with was the population's... When you travel up and down the country, people constantly repeated, I don't mind living in a multicultural society, I don't want it to happen so quickly. It's happening so quickly, I'm not a racist, I have my daughter is married to someone of a different heritage, but it's all happening so quickly. And there was a refusal to engage, I think, with the commentariat that historically there has been, you know, a dramatic change in Britain's ethnic structure. So if you go back to 1931 and you look when the Queen was 5 years old and you have a look at the country's ethnic structure, you have 1.75% of people in Britain who were born abroad, and in London, you have 2.75% of people who were born abroad. Come today, you have around 10% of the population who were born abroad. You have 12% of the population who are of sort of non-white heritage. In London, you have 40% of the population who's born abroad. That's pretty dramatic. And if you can say that's a great thing, I think that's a good thing. You can say it's a bad thing, but don't say it's not a thing. It's no, like, yeah. And there was a refusal to engage with that.
By the politicians or by the...
No, I think that by a liberal left-wing kind cosmopolitan intelligentsia that doesn't take ideas of history or place or identity seriously and doesn't acknowledge that voters take those seriously.
Is that right, or is it actually that they thought that this was a beneficial, they liked a cosmopolitan Britain, they could see the benefits of migration, the benefits of migration overwhelmingly accrued to them?
I don't think that North London is a cosmopolitan place, and I don't... If you look at the most cosmopolitan parts of Britain, or the most working-class parts of Britain, the least cosmopolitan are public schools and are the sort of upper-class environments, and indeed newsrooms, which still have that 1930s ethnic structure.
For a subject that we're all supposed to be too afraid to mention in Britain, migration takes up a huge percentage of the debate that goes on amongst the commentariat. What I want to say is I woke up in a very different, in the exact opposite from Alex. I live in Lambeth, which is the most pro-Remain place in the whole country, and was very proud of that the next morning. It was about the only thing. I saw people crying on the tube that morning at Brixton when they got on. So we were only beaten by Gibraltar. Gibraltar, obviously, very, very pro-Remain for clear reasons there, to do with Spain's plans for Gibraltar now. But what struck me about this is that a lot of the people most hard hit by all these things we're talking about, and the gig economy, they're young, and the young people in Britain overwhelmingly backed Remain. Now, they didn't all come out and vote, although now we think a majority did. But they overwhelmingly were in favour of staying in the EU, and that was to do partly with identity. And I think there is a genuine thing where they see themselves as culturally European. But I think the issue I would have with this idea, Lambeth is an incredibly diverse place. It is one of the most diverse places in the country. It has various waves of immigration that have come into it, and people there see that as a strength. So I don't think it's uniformly a rejection of that. There are places in London, Lambeth is not a wealthy borough, I should add that too. This isn't just about poor people wanting to give the establishment a kicking, because Lambeth is an incredibly, it's got the biggest gap between the rich and poor anywhere in London. And so I think it's very interesting that that's a place that actually was very, very pro-Remain. And I think it actually, when you think about that, it sort of undermines some of the more simplistic arguments about the economics of Brexit.
Although once you take into account the ethnic makeup of the, because this is the point, that it was the white working classes, it was the white precariat. I heard Ben using that very useful term in the earlier talk. It was the white precariat who were feeling marginalised. Actually, you know, love or hate Uber, there are people who are working ridiculous hours and for too little pay, but are working very hard, and they tend to be from ethnic minority groups.
And actually, the further you go from cosmopolitan areas, I mean, London overwhelmingly was Remain. The further you went from, as soon as you left London, you got into Leave territory, and almost every window and every field, the farmers had put up great, you know, farmers, huge beneficiaries of Europe, by the way, had put up great Leave posters. Yeah. And it was very much, the whiter it was, the more Leave people tended to be.
Well, that was this idea of identity politics that I think, I think it can be overdone as an idea, but I do think there was a sense that the reasons for remaining, and one of my good friends from university ran the Remain campaign, Will Straw, and I think what they didn't do was find a way of vocalizing in our, rushed Facebook, BuzzFeed world, the arguments for remaining in a clear and accessible way, in the way that the Leave campaign did.
But they were also terribly hampered by the fact that they were trying to run a three-party, campaign to support it, and the parties refused to cooperate. I mean,
Dominic Cummings.
But how well were we served by our politicians in the process of the referendum, do you think?
Well, ineptly. What we had, I don't want to leave all the blame at the Remain camp's door, because I think what they couldn't get, when you stuck people in rooms and asked them what are the messages of the Leave campaign, they had two that they kept coming up with. They talked about taking our country back, all the sovereignty stuff, but they also had this number, which was complete nonsense, as we're now seeing, which was about giving £350 million a week, which is being sent to Brussels, and it was on a bus saying we're going to give it to the National Health Service. Now, of course, that has not happened, and that will not happen, but they had a clear message. It may have been an untrue message, but it stuck in people's heads. And I think there was a real weakness that David Cameron did not make a passionate case for Europe. Personally, I feel a lot of anger at the way he handled this. It feels to me an utterly unnecessary referendum that was to do with party politics. It was only necessary in the sense of keeping the Conservative Party happy.
He called the referendum because he was worried about the inroads that UKIP, anti-European party, was making on the Tories.
The fascinating thing, at the last general election in 2015, the EU was the seventh most important issue for voters, and we didn't have a referendum on any of the top six there, which I think is very telling.
So, but look, it's more than just a howl of anguish by the vulnerable white working class. There's much more to it than that. And you hinted earlier that you've been trying to kind of sympathise with why people voted leave, and one of the reasons is that actually there are massive flaws in the European project, aren't there? And lots of people, when you talk to them, they said, listen, it's not democratic, and it's easy to dismiss that, but actually it's true. It is not a great democratic institution, the European Union. Policy tends to be formulated in the Commission, which is a bureaucracy, and then rubber stamped by politicians.
Unelected bureaucracy.
Unelected bureaucracy, and the elected politicians simply rubber stamp the policy that they're given. And rightly, people were angry about that, don't you think, Ben?
Well, when I spoke to your average voter going on a sort of loop through the country, the first issue was definitely the pace of ethnic change. And I want to be precise about that. It wasn't racism, it wasn't wanting to hurt people, it was just alarm at the pace of ethnic change. The second idea that really came up a lot was this worry that Britain was becoming overpopulated, and therefore there would be less housing or less of the NHS for them. And the immigrants were taking away the little that they had. The third idea that came up was a sort of anti-Germanism, the idea that Germany is ruling the EU secretly and that the Germans were after us here. And only then did you come up with this, tended to be the wealthier the voters were, the more this came up, was this idea, this horror of foreigners tampering on our laws and our laws not being decided by ourselves.
Is that something you found?
No, I think that's absolutely right. I think that as you, interestingly, I think there was a kind of barbell to the Leave voters. I think the vast majority, I think, were as we've spoken about, the kind of the precariat, the white working class, but also the very wealthy British, you know, upper middle classes. And I'm doing a long piece for The Guardian at the moment where I've gone to speak to, I think probably not nowhere near as many as Ben, but a lot of bankers in the city of London, financiers, and talking to them about what they really voted, because many of them said internally in their banks that they were voting Remain but actually voted Leave. And then there were a number of high-profile hedge fund managers, yeah, who, Crispin Odie, I've spent a lot of time with, talking to them, you know, from my perspective, the economic reasons for staying in the EU are absolutely clear. It has been very interesting speaking to some very, very bright people in the city who had absolutely the other view.
Okay, go on, tell us. What are the economic benefits of leaving?
The economic benefits of being in. The first one is this idea that...
No, not of being in, because I think it's the presumption...
Oh, sorry,
of leaving.
On your own. Yeah. The first one is that you are able to negotiate kind of bespoke deals with all sorts of people all around the world in a way that the EU was too cumbersome to do. I think it's faintly ridiculous. I think the much more compelling reason is that the EU, that their view is that the EU project is fundamentally flawed, that the euro is a catastrophe waiting to happen. 2008, I think, is responsible for a lot of this. At that end of that, you know, it doesn't, I think maybe indirectly for the kind of precariat, but for those upper middle class, wealthy voters who voted Leave, I think it is the scars of 2008. I think it was seeing how the one-size-fits-all policies enacted at the EU just weren't able to respond quickly enough. And independent, you know, Ireland's problems in 2008 were not the same as Greece's problems, were not the same as Portugal and Spain's problems. Many of these actually were caused, or certainly were not halted by the fact that there were, you know, monetary policy and fiscal policy were largely centralized for those places. And they saw us being sucked further and further into this monolith that would not allow us to respond nimbly to another 2008.
I think that is a very important theme, that sense that that deepening and widening the European project, which was the stated objective in Europe, lots of people found that frightening. So even if they weren't worried directly about Europe, they were worried about the prospect that this was an ever-extending project that would go deeper and deeper.
Well, when people write the history of the European Union and try and work out what went wrong, there will be many chapters about the flaws that went into the euro. There will be more than we expect now, lots of discussion about the expansion to Eastern Europe and the flawed intellectual thinking that went into that. And the prime piece of flawed intellectual thinking was simply not realizing that if you admit countries significantly poorer, that there would be a mass migration. And it was completely unanticipated.
I don't think it was completely unanticipated, was it? I'm sure that they knew that there was going to be migration.
The internal British government studies by a gentleman called Jonathan Ports, who's a mixture of a liberal troll and an economist, anticipated that the numbers would be in the tens of thousands.
But and Tony, in fact, you Blair's have. Tony Blair's speechwriter has since said that it was a plan, basically, by Tony Blair.
A plan, hasn't to he? What? Just explain.
Okay. So Tim Shipman has just written a book about Brexit. And one of the arguments, it's not his argument, but that he puts forward, is that a lot of the fault should actually fall on Tony Blair. And of course, he is the person that gets blamed for everything in Britain. It's sort of a bit of a running joke. But Michael McManus is the person who made this argument, and he used to work for Ted Heath. And what he was saying here, and you can understand this argument even if you don't agree with it, is that Blair was obviously very keen on Eastern European countries joining the EU. And he didn't really put up the protest about borders that he could have. And the what was said by his speechwriter, and that it has been denied, but is that he was encouraging immigration into Britain because these were likely Labour voters. They were people who were going to be supportive of him. Anyway, so what that did, this policy, is it undermined public trust in the government's ability to handle the issue of immigration. And then on top of that, obviously, I don't want to delve into the Iraq War, but some people would say it's the catalyst for a lot, one of many catalysts for a lot of the movement people that we've seen.
And therefore we have a moral obligation to deal with the migrant problem. I think that's absolutely true.
But also that played into anti-EU feeling because it was an anti-immigrant vote.
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
And I want to draw on...
I don't think anybody estimated the amount of people who would leave Eastern Europe. No. So you have about 10% of the population of Romania that now work as migrant labour abroad. And you have over between 4 and 6 million Central and Eastern Europeans now working in Western Europe. That was completely unanticipated. And the reason that scale was completely unanticipated was because Western European leaders looked at the overall GDP and overall GDP per capita of these countries without realizing that post-communist agriculture has basically never recovered. And that all of the wealth was being concentrated in places like sort of Warsaw and Bucharest and Sofia, and the countryside was still stuck in the early 90s.
Okay, so that wasn't anticipated. And then, I mean, I don't know whether you guys agree with this, let me throw it out there. There was a failure of politicians on both sides to recognize the concerns that people had about migration. So they weren't addressed. People weren't talking about the effect it had on, you know, ability to get council housing and that kind of thing.
Yeah, well, I did a lot of, for my book on London, it's the sort of portrait of an immigrant city in which it was, each chapter is a different sort of immigrant or immigrant experience in London. And a lot of it I did it sort of undercover in the sort of Orwellian tradition. And what I was really stunned by in the poorer parts of London was the unenforcement of law, which is you have extensive DOS houses, massively crammed, filled illegal flats and illegal hostels where I went pretending to be an Eastern European and lived in. And then there's also these illegal labour exchanges, which are really everywhere in outer London, where people just sort of tout for work on the street corner. And that was not dealt with as a consequence of government cuts falling on local authorities, because it was up to Barking Council to deal with this. But Barking Council couldn't deal with it because all of local councils in the UK had lost a third of their budget due to Cameron's austerity politics.
I was making a slightly different point, that none of the parties were articulating the concerns of, for example, you know, people like plumbers and labourers and stuff who were finding that there was much more competition.
Can I just give a little example of that I think might... Yeah, so one of the people I was speaking to, literally the day after the vote, was saying that... He used to go up to London to where he was a plaster painter decorator. He used to go up to London to work, and would spend the majority of the year working in London and would only occasionally come back to Kent to work. He says that labour, the labour that you get just picking up on the day, so exactly those kind of labour exchanges have destroyed the transitory migratory labour that used to go from outside of London into London. He said, the reason I voted Leave was because I want to be able to do the job that I used to do in the 1980s and early 90s, that when this opened up and when suddenly there are Lithuanians and Poles who are offering to work for well under the legal minimum wage and who are offering to work hours that are wholly illegal, it's no longer worth the petrol money to me to go up to London.
But that was not something. I'm thinking mostly of Labour here. That's not something that Labour
recognised.
Well,
there was a huge
Labour was getting anxious about.
I disagree
about,
with that.
Okay. Yeah.
I disagree with that. Actually, we have very good law on statutes, and it is illegal to have an illegal labour exchange. It's illegal to employ a worker without insurance, and the previous few governments created a stronger regulatory environment. It was just that these laws were not being enforced on the ground because the local councils were being gutted. So it's not central government's or for its responsibility to make sure there isn't an illegal Labour exchange at the Barking Wicks. It's up to Barking Council.
But, for example, you know, the points system for council housing meant that immigrants were more likely, immigrants with large families, for example, were more likely to get to council houses. I've got friends in London who've literally been on council waiting lists for 30 years before they got a home. And they felt, and she is the daughter of immigrants from South Asia, she felt that this was because she was being, you know, the system meant that she was being, you know, disfavoured because her family, despite being a single mum, her family was small. For example, that was not something that Labour politicians, you know, talked about.
There's been a lot of opposition in the Labour Party to that particular approach to council housing. Or just to sort of fill you in, I guess, is that council housing was distributed on a...
So council housing being housing that is provided by the government for those who can't afford to buy their own properties.
And it went up until it was changed to sort of who needs it more basis in the, I think it was in the late 70s?
Hmm.
It was distributed on sort of, if your family was from the area or if your family already lived in the block, you could have access first. And that meant in London that white working class Cockney families immediately went to the bottom of the list because immigrant families with five kids would automatically be at the top of this. But there's been a lot of anger and opposition about that.
But I think maybe the point you were getting at is that there was a real reluctance to talk about race.
There was a massive reluctance.
And I think there was a reluctance to talk. I mean, Ros, do you agree that I mean, you read the press more than I do.
Well, I don't feel like we haven't had a debate on immigration. And this is the thing that people keep saying.
But when did the debate happen? The debate happened around Brexit. There's no question about that.
I read the Daily Mail every day. Oh, it's in there. Probably, I read every newspaper. Now, I get that it's not in probably what we're reading, the Guardian or the... It is in the Times, though. It's in the Telegraph. It's in, you know, it's certainly in the Daily Express, which is a very right-wing paper. I mean, I feel like their paper every day, you know, when it's not any of their other bugbears.
So actually what we're saying is the Guardian didn't, and you know, that's it's very true that we gravitate towards, and this is why, you know, so many people were so astonished when Brexit was voted for, not only because the polls were all saying it's going to go our way, but because people like the Guardian were all saying, don't worry, it's going to be fine.
Can I add something about the media, though, that I think is really relevant?
Let's do the media first, then I want to do polls.
Well, one of the things we haven't talked about is the fact that, and the journalist who's responsible for this is very interesting. So what started happening in our press, I don't really know when it all kicked off, but you've got these stories coming out of the EU wants us to have specific kinds of bananas.
Yeah.
And there was this specific kind of journalism. Now, before, covering the EU had been really, really boring. Being Brussels correspondent was a boring job. And then some journalist turned up and he found this way of getting all the stories that the Daily Telegraph loved publishing. And that journalist was Boris Johnson. And one of the best pieces I read after possibly even before Brexit, was somebody who'd been out there, and I'm really sorry, but I can't remember who this was by, but it is excellent, Brussels correspondent who had been out there at the same time as Boris and said basically the way the reporting on the EU went, it just got manipulated because suddenly the media had this enormous appetite for putting these stories on the front page about silly bananas or whatever. You know, whatever it was, I mean, it was some, what is the banana thing?
Straight bananas, you can't sell straight,
you know. And all these silly nonsense little things that were coming out of Europe, most of which weren't even true.
And he would just manipulate the point.
I'm not sure we can pin the whole of the crazy EU regulation. That was a huge theme in British reporting of the European Union. I'm not sure it was all Boris, but I'm sure he did play.
He kicked it off.
He did kick it off, and he was certainly a very provocative European correspondent when he was there. Let's do the polling first, because this, I want to say, let's push this out elsewhere and talk about the themes in Britain that echo elsewhere in the world. And let's do that by looking at polling. You brought up polling and the failure of polling to adequately predict what was going to happen. And I think one of the interesting things that happened there, it seems clear that people didn't want to tell people the way they were going to vote because they felt guilty. They knew that what they were doing, they felt what they were doing was wrong, and they didn't want to admit to it. Well, so you saw that with Trump, you saw that with Brexit.
I'm not sure it's quite that. So for me, what went wrong in the polls is the people who never voted, some of them actually came out, and they came out quite big numbers. And so they were discounted. They were polled, but then they got statistically taken out, which obviously is the the very clever way that they do these polling things. And so what happened is they overestimated the number of people who weren't going to vote, or the specific groups they came from, rather. And actually, they did turn out. And I think that's one of the things. And also, actually, internet
polls
were
in America,
much better than
phone
polls.
In the Rust Belt of America, they assumed that they didn't realize that people who'd voted Obama were going to swing all the way over to Trump. And there was a huge swing among white working class voters.
Because
we
exactly
about
what she
shy
said,
voters.
Because they... Because a lot of those people had never voted before.
Oh, okay. Yeah, it's
and,
a turnout issue.
It's actually interesting. If on the macro level, the national level, the polls were actually pretty accurate in the US, like putting Hillary Clinton slightly ahead and she won the popular vote. And on Brexit, they were within margin of error. Like, all of these polls come with this sort of 3% warning. It's just a question of where turnout will fall in the actual mechanics of politics.
But also, it's phone polling didn't work specifically in Britain. I don't know how true this is for the US, but internet polling actually had Leave, a lot of it had Leave winning for quite a long time beforehand.
So people are more honest on their computers than they are on the phone?
I'm not quite sure what the analysis is.
Let's go, because one of the great, you know, we've touched on this already in this debate, one of the themes of Brexit was this sense of dislocation and alienation that a large section of British society felt. You've already referred to that. Clearly that was something that was happening elsewhere in the world, in America, and I just wonder what you guys think about to what extent this is a global trend, to what extent we're seeing something that's kind of a fundamental change, or is this something confined to Western Europe
and America? It's also a very
English
story. Yeah. And in this year in over the last few years in British politics, you've seen both the Labour Party and the Conservative Party, in a sense, overwhelmed by two fringe traditions within both of them. And this is the revenge of two 1970s politicians. It's the revenge of Tony Benn, who was the mentor of Corbyn and MacDonald, and is the hero of all of the young journalists who sang the song of Corbyn as he sort of took over the Labour Party. And on the Conservative side, this is a doctrine that comes from Enoch Powell. One of the things that I did after Brexit, I went and I watched, because I'm that kind of person, the 1973 first common market commentary. The results came in. And there was Enoch Powell, who had led the campaign to Britain not to join the common market, which is the sort of predecessor of the European Union. And it was exactly the same slogans. Independence, we need to take back control. The British people have given away control. We'll make the country independent again. And there is, we don't see it, that the hero who inspired Nigel Farage to go into politics, his hero, he's not my hero, was Enoch Powell. And Farage repeatedly asked him to stand for UKIP. Dan Hannan, the sort of orator in the European Parliament, his hero was Enoch Powell. If we look at a lot of conservative journalists, people like Tim Montgomery, hero is Enoch Powell.
Yeah, I'm quite keen now to push it out away from British politics and elsewhere, and to look at
whether
what we're seeing, the kind
of British politics.
Well, I'm really interested to hear from Ben, the role of Russia in all of this.
Yeah,
because I think that is something that, you know, that I think links all of this together. I mean, Putin was cheering for Brexit, as I understand it, is clearly, you know, best buddies with Mr. Trump. What is this just about Putin benefiting from an unstable Europe?
Sorry, if I may
Europe.
Just take over the chair just for a moment, because there was a brilliant there was a fantastic quote that you had from Philip Breedlove in an article that you wrote, who's the NATO Supreme Commander, and he talks about, I don't know, I'll quote it for you if you probably can't remember it off the top of your head, but he talks about how Russia weaponized migration in an attempt to overwhelm European structures and break European resolve, and talked about how he was bombing Syria into a refugee factory. Now, do you really believe that that was Russia's intention, that it saw that as a consequence of what it was doing in Syria?
The Assad sort of based alliance is trying to empty sort of swathes of Syria to create ethnic cleansing for the benefit of the Shia kind of Alawite population, and to push this population out of the combat zone. And they know full well that these refugees are ending up in Turkey and then in Europe.
Did they see that? Do you think this was an attempt to destabilize Europe, which is the implication of that quote?
Well, there were a lot of incidents when the migration crisis was flaring, of there being sort of provocateurs sort of that in some countries appear to have been linked to the Russian embassy, especially in Hungary, trying to create sort of migrant riots. And then German intelligence actually came out and made a few declarations, those reasons which only last week, saying that there's been a weaponization of fake news about migrants, in which Russia Today started manufacturing these stories about white blonde girls being raped by sort of Syrian men, and this was an attempt to sort of bring down sort of Merkel's popularity.
Another thing you've written about is the Russians funding, you know, which used to be the source of funding for the far left, for communists in Europe, now funding far right movements. Now, what is the long-term agenda Russia has there? Why is Russia so anti the European project, and how successful do you think it's going to be in its efforts to shake it?
Russia's very open about what its grand strategy has been. There's no secret. It's that Russia believes that it wants to return the world to a concert of great powers. It has a sphere of privileged interests, which is the territory of the former Russian Empire, where it believes these countries can be nominally independent but not have an independent foreign policy, and Russia should have privileged access to their resources and their political class. It believes that the European Union is a sort of Soviet construction, which is a German hegemonic sphere in disguise, and it believes that Euro-Atlantic institutions and an American sort of Soviet alliance structure, which should be snapped and should be undermined. It wants to return to the role that it played in the 1980s as a sort of global center of power and influence. And what Russia would like to replace NATO and the Euro-Atlantic institutions with, and they've even created drafts of this, is a new European security treaty in which Russia would join a watered-down version of NATO to basically destroy it. And or it could be a souped-up version of the OSCE.
But it's interesting, isn't it? Because there's a why. I mean, obviously, we saw Russian influence in the American election, and this kind of idea that Russia's projecting power to destabilize the traditional kind of alliances that exist in the world. I mean, this is really quite an interesting and quite frightening. I was quite surprised that there was less anger in America. There wasn't more anger in America about the way in which Russia had attempted to use the emails of Hillary Clinton.
There are new enemies, aren't there? This is the thing that there is no longer a generation for whom Russia are the bad guys. The bad guys are now from the places that America wants to bomb out of existence.
But the particular technique that Putin has been experimenting with and been using, it only really professionalized in the US election. And there are various key moments if you track...
You mean this using cyber intelligence?
If you look at how the Russian information warfare on the US election went, when it started to have to really take off after the DNC hacked, a lot more resources were put behind it, and it really professionalized.
So the hack of the emails in the Democratic Party, which revealed these.
So with
these
looking at kind of Russian influence over Brexit, like Russia Today has been a megaphone for the UKIP and for the hard left,
which is the Russian international news channel,
which are very popular all over the world. I'm sure people in this room who watch Russia Today. And Russia Today successfully became the first news channel, the first account on YouTube to have a billion views. Only yesterday I checked how many they got 1.8 billion views. It was a very successful project for spreading kind of memes. And the Russian information warfare understands how Facebook has changed our political debate and Twitter has changed our political debate. There were also a lot of contacts between Aaron Banks, who was a sort of funder of Brexit, and the Russian embassy. He met the Russian ambassador. He was proud to have met the Russian ambassador and to drink with the Russian ambassador. And his wife is Russian. And we don't know where a lot of funding for Brexit came from. And there are a lot of sort of murky questions there. One of the things that's quite interesting about Farage is I've gone to various of these miserable town hall events where Farage speaks, and they put a box in the middle of the table for people to put in a question for Nigel. There are only ever like two or three questions for Nigel ever get put in. So I always put it like in a granny handwriting. Nigel, how do you react to Russian expansionism in Eastern Europe? And they never read the question. The question's always kind of thrown away.
So listen, what do we think, what effect do we think Brexit has had on the future of Europe? We're going to throw this open to the floor soon, so let's be quite quick. We're running out of time. Let's start with you, Alex. I mean, is the European project over? How damaging is this?
I think that probably there will continue to be a limited European project. I think thinking about, I was saying earlier that I wanted to be optimistic about this. I think this has energized a group of people in the UK politically who hadn't been energized before. They feel, young people feel that their future has been taken from them, or at least some part of their identity has been taken from them. And so I think, thinking optimistically, this has certainly
given people something to care about?
Well, Nicolas Sarkozy was saying only, I think, yesterday that the EU should reform into something that Britain wants to rejoin. So there is now impetus behind reform. We haven't talked about Scotland at all, and Scotland, an independent Scotland, theoretically might want to join the EU, and we haven't talked about Ireland and the border, which is another interesting issue, that we now have a physical border, which we obviously, well, could have a physical border between Northern Ireland and the Republic, which obviously for people living in the Republic, of whom my family come there originally, and this was something wasn't talked about at all in the run-up, the referendum, the damage that will do to a place that has had so many problems during the Troubles, and whether that revives tensions there, I think that's something we should be really worried about.
Ben, the future of Europe.
Well, we had the Brexit vote, but now we have the Brexit war, in which Britain will leave the European Union. The question is, how far will Britain leave the European Union? And because this has now become it's been taken away from a question of referendum, and it's now very much a battle within Westminster, the power of lobbyists, the power of the City of London, the power of different factions of the Conservative Party, decisions by the Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats will shape whether or not we stay in the single market, or we stay in the economic institutions of the European Union, but not in the political ones, whether we stay in some of
these are questions for Britain. What do you think about the future of Europe?
I think the future of Europe is going to be far more shaped by the future of America than by the future of Britain. And there has been, over the last few weeks, like a very serious strategic conversation that's happening in Germany, and a lot of big statements from people who don't normally make them, like the head of German intelligence, the both sides of the political divide in Germany, Merkel potentially looking for a new term, and the talk about Germany assuming its responsibility as a guarantor of the liberal order. Obama is actually, he was in Berlin yesterday, and there has been a lot of talk about him telling Merkel to assume responsibility as guarantor of the liberal order.
Is that part? I mean, could Germany do that, do you think? Is it feasible?
Well, Germany could play a far more significant foreign policy role in the world than it does today, sure. And that would involve, if Germany was serious about that, it would involve Germany taking much more radical steps than it's done so far to shore up the euro and to shore up Greece or Ireland or other ways. And it would involve Germany taking a far more assertive and independent role towards Russia.
Right, we need to throw this open. I mean, who has... I haven't been able to see. If people have put their hands up, I couldn't see them because the lights were down. Guy at the back, you were very quick in the blue shirt there. Keep your hand up so the guy with the mic can see you. Yeah, just over there. Can you see him? And everybody put their hands up who wants to yell and come to you next. Is there a second mic?
Thank you. Basically, I have two questions.
The just one question. Choose your favorite one. Just one.
Okay, I'm going to wrap up them both then.
Okay.
Every time the word migrants were uttered here, I mean there, in that stage, it was followed by another word called problem. Migration problem or migrants problem. Why not address it at migration blessing or migration assets? Every time, you know, the migrants... England or Britain attract the migrants because it is a good land. It is a land of opportunities. Opportunities that doesn't shape, that doesn't reincarnate in nations like South Asia.
Very, very good point. I mean, migration is a benefit for societies. It tends to be associated with economic growth. That message was never conveyed. That was never persuasively argued.
Couldn't agree more, and it's exactly what I argued in the run-up to the referendum, but it is a very unfashionable argument in Britain, and you have to be realistic about the fact that argument, the level of abuse you get seen before that. What I would add, London's mayor is somebody who is the child of migrants and grew up in a council house with, I think, six siblings. So, London, you're absolutely right, we can make that person our mayor, but I think it doesn't play that well outside London, and maybe people like me have to be realistic about that.
Another point, just very quickly, which is that the second generation of immigrants often feel very vulnerable about the next wave of immigration. So you found a lot of immigrants from South Asia, the kids of immigrants from South Asia, the second generation, who were very anxious about migration for the reasons that Alex so articulately put earlier. Let's hear this question. Elite memo. Yeah, I can hear you, so I can
That's better.
It's the Treasury memo. Yeah.
Yes, so recently there was this leaked memo saying that there's no plan for Brexit. So considering that, are you all optimistic about Brexit or are you pessimistic about it?
Alex? Deeply pessimistic. I don't think anyone thought that this would happen. I think that they have no plan. I think they are steering their way towards a hard Brexit, which is everything in force. Imagine if it had been Remain and we tried to do a hard Remain, you know, baguettes on every street corner. It's absurd.
Okay, there's a question at the front here. Look, there's loads of questions. So whoever's on this side, could you get the mic to this guy? Thanks. And then I'm going to take, there's a question over there. Yeah, could we get a mic over there? Sorry, I'm making you work here. Take the question.
So if Article 50 is triggered, there's a chance that you can still reverse the decision. So would it actually happen? And if it does happen, what other alternative trade blocks are you looking for?
This one's for you.
Well, I think that as I said, there's a Brexit vote and there's a Brexit war to shape Brexit. And this is going to be fascinating because it will tell us what are the most powerful forces in our country. Are the most powerful forces the City of London, that wants to remain in the single market and wants to remain, indeed, even closer than that, to have access to what's called passporting, which permits banks based in London to have all the access they want to the rest of the European Union? Or actually politicians, like more important? Will it be the sort of right of the Conservative Party that's more powerful than the City of London? So I'm really looking forward to that just as an analytical point of view to see where power lands. Article 50 is reversible. If you start it, you can not go through with it. In terms of the options that are available...
Quite a hard thing politically for Britain to do would be to, you know...
Unless we had a general election in which a party ran on the platform of reversing Article 50, I think otherwise it's basically impossible,
that's
isn't
absolutely
it?
Fair. Sorry, let me go to the question here, yeah.
Hi. I was just really interested in, with Spain, and there's still really high levels of unemployment, like 50% of youth are very much unemployed. You've got issues in Italy with the high migration, and then very much feeling like they're dealing with that on their own, with Greece, obviously with the economic breakdown and then the migrants. And I wondered what you see as the future in terms of the EU project and the fact that it's really failing to deal with a lot of issues that Britain, whilst was minorly affected, actually there's huge issues along that coastal region that are not being dealt with.
I would go to you, but you've already kind of answered that question, so I'm going to ask you, Roz, if that's all right. If there are more questions, please put your hands up and we'll get a mic to you.
One of the symptoms of the fact that there are massive economic problems for the young in Spain is that a hell of a lot of them come to London. Yeah. So I'm afraid, and I'm probably far overqualified people end up working in our Prets. It's a running joke in our office, unfortunately, of the good-looking Spanish staff there, who probably have, you know, degrees and really shouldn't be there. So I absolutely agree, and one can't understate how enormous those problems are for those countries. And I completely agree. The ridiculous thing about Brexit is I feel we actually got a hell of a lot of advantages of being in the EU, and we were actually one of the countries benefiting the most from it. If you look at where our economy was before we joined, you know, we were the sort of sick, dying man or whatever of Europe. That was how, and then suddenly we've done incredibly well out of it, and other countries actually haven't done as well, but might believe more in the European project.
So I can't remember all the acronyms, but are you expecting Spexit? And I can't, what's the Italian one? I can't remember.
Well,
but, you know, are we expecting a wave of exits from Europe? Just very quickly, because we've got these questions. Who wants to?
Well, I think that historically, the crucible of Europe has always been France, and how France...
You mean
the
European Union, the European project?
Yes,
this latest,
I think,
well,
France has been the crucible of Europe from the 18th century. And if France votes Marine Le Pen in April, then that is the end of the European Union.
I absolutely agree.
If France elects a lot of some of the other candidates on offer, who are mostly very pro a more federal Europe and want a common European treasury, we can move in a different direction.
Okay, question there, please, and then we'll come to you.
Do you think Brexit is going to trigger into the breakdown of the United Kingdom as we now know it, into independent Scotland and other dominions?
Yeah, we've got to go there. I know you're dying to talk about this. Is Scotland going to leave?
Yes, I think so. But I think it's going to... Obviously, we had a referendum in Scotland just before this one. We've had far too many referendums. Obviously, Scotland voted, just for clarity's sake, to remain in the EU overall. And you've got to think that, and the Scottish National Party is in power, and, well, has almost all of the seats in Scotland. So you've got to think that given that they're very pro-EU, how can Scotland feel, and I don't know, I just can't imagine that we won't get another independence referendum, and there are lots of catalysts to suggest it might come a bit quicker. However, having said that, the SNP is in a very happy position at the moment where it can blame a lot on Westminster. Yeah. And say all these problems are Westminster's fault when anything goes wrong. And I don't think it's a very coherent party as well. That's the other part of the analysis. It's really important. You've got people who simply want an independent Scotland, but how tied are they politically? There's lots and lots of sort of, they're very broad party in terms of what else they stand for.
That was a brilliant summary. One other factor that, you know, is the obviously that the oil price has turned some of the economic arguments that were more persuasive against Scotland. There's another, sorry, this is a bit rude, but I just want to interject because it struck me listening to you talk. There's one question that should have been on my list that I haven't asked, which is, what do we think about this kind of, these referendums that the British Parliament has decided to not use its power and hand power over to referendums? I mean, is that referendums, however we want? I think referendums is probably neater. What do you think of that as a way of doing business?
We are a parliamentary democracy, and I think it is politicians wimping out of actually doing what they are elected to do. We have a system where MPs, we elect them, we choose them. It's not as though that, and I don't think things will be put, and the ridiculousness of a complex economic issue being put to a binary question, and not even a very well phrased question at that, is absolutely ludicrous. I mean, how could you have a referendum on something so complex and not ask what form Brexit should take if we had it?
Yeah, exactly. That's incredible. Please.
Yes, hello. I'm from Denmark, and I think Denmark used to be more Eurosceptic than the UK. Actually, we had our Brexit in 1992, and you helped us back into the EU and with the Edinburgh Agreement. Danish foreign policy has rested on two pillars. The UK and the US both have crumbled in a very short time. I think there was an expectation that there would be a lot of similar movements to get out of the EU, but I think the mood in a lot of European countries is really to stay in the EU because the mess that we are now seeing in the UK is actually not very attractive.
Okay, and so we're a good reason for not leaving
Europe. And there's a movement towards Germany.
Okay.
But Germany was our historic sort of enemy. So that movement is also a bit reluctant.
Excellent. Okay, thank you very much indeed. There's a question over here.
Yeah. My question is more related to the migration in the UK, where it appears that there is an ethnic majority English backlash because of the British government's immigration policy. So there we can see that people from the ex-British colonies are coming in, and also from Eastern Europe, especially the people who are coming from the Orient with their own kind of cultural and deep religious values. So, I mean, they find it difficult to assimilate with the mainstream society, and the mainstream society also find it to accept the distinctly cultural and religious people. So should there anything be done in the immigration policy of the US so that liberal people can get in there, but the deeply religious people or culturally very very intense people who cannot assimilate with the mainstream society. So there can be...
I think that's a really interesting point, and the balance of migration is one of the really interesting issues that came out of the whole debate, and the idea that now Britain would have more discretion, for example, to take more migrants from your former colonies in South Asia, India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and fewer from Europe, because while it was a member of the European Union, overwhelmingly it had to accept migrants from Europe.
Yeah, I mean, this is about the makeup of the, and also about how those migrants are then integrated into society. So I think there is definitely a suggestion that Brexit might change the makeup of those who we accept. Obviously, these ideas of points-based systems, which the Australian system, which I think is ludicrous and appalling. But absolutely, it could mean that more people from countries around here could come in.
Excellent. We are going to have to wind this up.
The majority of British Sikhs voted to leave.
We're going to have to wind it up. I'm going to give you a question, and then we go
on what Ben you mentioned about the fact that there was the militarization of the Syrian refugee issue by the Russians,
yes.
And also about the fact that Russia interfered within the elections in the USA. I think that's a slightly narrow view, because the reason is that What has happened from Syria is actually been preceded by what has happened by the refugees from Libya that has come in, from Yemen that have come in, boatloads that have come in.
Yeah.
In most of these cases, it is Western intervention in these countries which has caused this issue. Don't you think that actually Britain is reaping what they have sowed in the Middle East?
Yeah, I mean, I think
and
that's
this
exactly
refugee
what
problem
I said.
Has been created by the West.
I think I'm really sorry. That, I mean, you've made your comment. That's really a comment rather than a question, I think, yeah. I'm going to assume. And
but I think we would all agree.
Thank you very much indeed for that. I'm being told, I'm sorry, that we've already finished. And rather mischievously, I do have one last question that I want to ask the panel, which is this. We talked right at the beginning, we reminded everybody of that incredible image of Trump and Farage in front of those extraordinary gold lift doors in Trump Towers in New York. Now, is it time, do you think, that Nigel Farage was given the peerage that a politician of his stature and influence, it is argued, so richly deserves? And I'm going to start with you, Alex. Does he deserve a peerage? Should he be in the House of Lords?
I would like to see him fired from a cannon towards France.
That is not an answer to my question. So you say he doesn't deserve a peerage?
Absolutely. You know, he expresses the worst side of a Britain that I do not recognise as my own.
But he articulates the views of millions of people, as has been shown by the referendum. Surely that he deserves a place in our senior house as a result, doesn't he?
I'm not sure that a place in the House of... you know, probably, and it says something about the House of Lords.
Well, he's supposed to represent the people. I mean, you know, what do you think?
Well, people were saying that he is the politician who's had the most profound effect on our politics in Britain. He's had the most profound effect in the way the iceberg had on the Titanic. And I also think that he went into the European Parliament, where, by the way, he's still accepting an MEP's salary, which he's going to take until we leave. He went in there the next day and insulted a load of incredibly impressive people from across Europe who are other MEPs and said that they were all worth.
Listen,
and they were a lot more impressive than
isn't
him.
One of the founding principles of democracy that you have to hear everyone's arguments, and the point of having an upper house is to reflect the views of Britain, Ben.
Well, if the Trump administration really turns out to be as kleptocratic, sclerotic, mad, dangerous, difficult to talk to as we fear, then I think he could be quite useful. He's not, I wouldn't want him around for dinner, I wouldn't sort of put him in my fantasy football team, but the Foreign Office is struggling over Trump telling Theresa May, let me know if you're ever in New York. And
listen, on that rather bizarre note, I'm being told we absolutely now have to go. So thank you very much indeed for coming.